Good evening, everyone. Welcome to the ICA. I'm Monica Garza, the Director of Education here. And I'm very excited to introduce you to tonight's program with artists Sheila Hicks and Jenelle Porter, the Mannion Family Senior Curator. This free event is part of the ICA's ongoing lecture series, The Artist's Voice, which highlights art practices of today's leading artists and thinkers. And I should mention here that we will be hosting a second program to accompany Fiber Sculpture, 1960 to the Present exhibition. And artists Faith Wilding and Beryl Carrot have made very important contributions over the years to our own understanding of art, technology, and feminism. They'll be coming back and joining us on November 6th, so I hope everyone will have an opportunity to come back. Now, let me introduce you to tonight's speakers. Sheila Hicks received her undergraduate and graduate degrees from Yale University. While in South America on a Fulbright, she developed her interest in working with fibers. And correct me if I'm wrong, Sheila. She founded workshops in Mexico, Chile, and South Africa, and worked in Morocco and India. Sheila's work has been widely exhibited in international solo and group exhibitions. A major retrospective, Sheila Hicks, 50 Years, was presented at the Addison Gallery and traveled to ICA Philly and the Mint Museum in Charlotte, North Carolina. Her work is also included in numerous collections, such as the Metropolitan Museum of Art, Museo de Bellas Artes, Santiago, Chile, the Museum of Modern Art in Tokyo, and the ICA Boston. Sheila has also received various prestigious awards over the years, including an honorary doctorate from the Rhode Island School of Design. Sheila will be sharing the stage tonight with Jenelle Porter. Jenelle joined the ICA curatorial team in 2011 as the museum's Mannion Family Senior Curator. Since her arrival, she has organized numerous exhibitions featuring artists such as Kathy Butterly, Felix Gonzalez-Torres, Christina Ramberg, and Nick Cave. Jenelle is also leading an ambitious 18-month-long residency with the interdisciplinary artist Matthew Ritchie. Jenelle's latest exhibition, Fiber Sculpture, 1960 to the Present, opened just yesterday to the public. And for those of you who haven't had a chance to see the exhibition yet, please know that the galleries will remain open until 9 o'clock. So you'll might want to go back and visit.
Oh, we're going to keep them in here until...
No. And now, before I hand over the microphone to Jenelle, I just need to thank a few more people who continue to support our work here at the ICA. Major support for Fiber Sculpture, 1960 to the Present, is provided by the Andrew Mellon Foundation and the Andy Warhol Foundation for the Visual Arts. Additional support was also provided by the NEA, the Kobe Foundation, and many generous individuals. And lastly, I just want to welcome and thank the 100 art students that are here tonight from the Rhode Island School of Design, Mass Art, and Suffolk University. They're all here with their classes through a partnership with the ICA. And I really hope that the works upstairs and also tonight's programs will really inspire you in your own creative pursuits. And now, please help me welcome Sheila Hicks and Jenelle Porter.
Thank you. Thank you for being here with me, all the way from Paris. So here is how we are going to encounter your work tonight. We are going to show a few wonderful films on your work and on you, and we're going to talk over them. So just to give our visitors the lay of the land. Okay.
This is assuming there must be many, if not most of you, who have never seen anything I've done. And it's only fair to sort of lead in slowly before we make commentary about something that you haven't experienced visually, even though it's secondhand by film, and you'll experience it firsthand, of course, in Jenelle's exhibition upstairs. But this film was made by my son, and it's called Opening the Archives.
If I took these photographs in 1957,
yep. It's like I was a puppet master for you.
45, 55 years old, these kids. Maybe they're not even around anymore. These were taken in the Altiplano in Peru and Ecuador. This boy's knitting, and he's carrying this little lamb as he's knitting. It seemed to me as though he was knitting wool directly from the lamb's back. Look at his poncho. Beautiful. He has a felt hat that's a handmade felt hat. I learned how to make all these things when I was down there. These people have sort of impregnated my memory. I remember these faces, and I remember exactly what they were wearing. And I remember how they were making their things.
Can I ask you a question now?
And it all came together in my imagination.
These are in Otavalo, Ecuador.
So
these are all photographs I took.
Yeah, these are all photographs Sheila Hicks took.
The highlight of my
beautiful
day,
photographs.
Every day was to find
she, you traveled all through South America in the 1957. 57. When you were between your degrees, correct?
That's what caused me to think.
I had a Fulbright
yeah.
to go to Chile. And to get to Chile, I could go
in some way with a rock
the indirect route.
Yes. So this woman traveled mostly alone all through South America from the top to the bottom. And you stopped and lived in various towns and learned from local craftspeople. Here you are.
Slightly later.
Mm-hmm.
In Mexico, down in the Oaxaca region.
And you lived in Mexico from 1959 to 1964. So it's a sort of wonderful film of Sheila just talking about these wonderful images that she's made, and it shows kind of where you learned to work with some fibers, but also the ways that you were seeing the people and the landscape and the clothes and the structures and the architecture, and how those also come into the works in gorgeous ways. There's a picture you come to of a pier with all of the pilings. And you talk about how that structure informed a lot of your hanging works. Do you have a little more volume for a moment?
Natural setting.
I've never
Mexico
done a talk like this.
So
see,
I could just.
I don't know if I'm more interesting than this. This is very interesting.
The way things were made directly with the people who were making them, and
there
learning from them directly how to duplicate what they were doing, and then to spin off in my own direction and do my own versions. My real
what was this
drive
experience like
was
for you?
To try
this
and find out about
year of
I
travel.
Know about.
This well, and this was in Mexico.
Mm-hmm. Fibrous supplement.
When you were living there.
When I was living textile there,
materials.
Photographs,
kind of
those
an
photographs were bar,
to
by Mark
unknown.
Ribou.
Mm-hmm.
That's and the history of my work, I guess.
This is just before I make my first exhibition
and
in the United States,
just,
in the Art Institute of Chicago,
of weavings
in the
that
basement.
I made on little frames
in
and on
corridor,
the garden
because it didn't pertain to any department.
Down, wrapping a thread around to create some tension. And working
yeah, there's a photograph of this show, which was essentially
a
vitrine
in Mexico
with a few works in it, a few of your early works, and a title that said Textiles by Sheila Hicks, and a photo of you working, I think.
This is Matias Geritz, the sculptor in Mexico, who helped me organize the show in Mexico City.
Now, a lot of these names might not be familiar to a younger audience, but
which is
somehow
really
you landed down there with a bunch of very well-known and influential
but how
artists
do you keep perpetuating
that were perhaps
that,
a
throughout your life?
Slightly older generation than yourself.
How do you?
You were like the young girl down there.
To play seriously.
Not anymore.
And continue to explore, and not fall into the trap. Of
I beg to differ. You run circles around me.
Successes.
So Sheila, it's often noted.
This is my house in Chile.
When I went down on a Fulbright.
There you are.
To Chile.
When I had a Fulbright,
I did field
trips to
places
like
this.
There are the
this
pylons she's talking about in Chile, the island of Chile in the south of Chile.
Mm-hmm.
And you could walk under them when the tide was down.
This has a lot to
walk
do with
inside all of these
textile
pylons.
Sculpture and the kind of sculpture I've made.
I loved
the
it.
Cords
so, of course,
hanging.
The one in the show you'll see upstairs.
In fact, I just made one now for a show in Chicago.
Principally on this idea, being able to walk in.
Extremely close to this image.
Vertical aligned thrusts.
But I haven't really looked at this mm-hmm. photograph or this image for 20 years.
You, it's often noted that you studied at Yale with Josef Albers, but
this couple.
I'd like to hear you talk about, if you wouldn't mind, some of the other really influential people on you, especially as it pertains to your travels there, like Junius Bird and George Kubler.
Two or three.
These people influenced me a lot because they every morning came and sold an egg.
Which was this corrugated backdrop here.
In that basket.
I think this entered my
and I'd go out and buy it from them in Chile.
My
and they had a corrugated. You see that corrugated
it keeps coming up
horizontal?
In my textiles.
Mm-hmm. I used that over and over again in the weaving
in the
because the corrugated facade had been bent and damaged as it was being rolled. And I loved those indentures, the interruptions of the horizontal weft.
You can't go to India and not be affected by the color.
And I based a whole collection of textiles in India.
You can't go to India and not
be on those inserted, hand-inserted wefts that were discontinuous. Here's a way I... We always talk about women's work, but I worked with men there who were the weavers and the women were the spinners.
And the color.
In India.
In India, Malabar Coast.
And you worked with them in terms of industry, correct? You.
That was my group of my pilot workshop down in the old hand-weaving factory called Comtrust. I would go down every year and do the export collection for them, which was then marketed in Scandinavia, Sweden, Denmark,
methods,
Helsinki.
Think of what I can,
so you worked with companies earlier in your career, and you still do. Perhaps you can talk about how that, you know, the fluidity you see in your career in terms of commissions and work for industry, your own sculpture. Would you care to talk more about that?
I have a very private, quiet studio. And then I go out into other people's noisy studios and their development sort of annexes where they often have very big industrial complexes. Here they're rolling and twisting and making coconut fiber.
Do you see these twists?
Isn't that beautiful?
On this coconut fiber.
I use that in my work of what I think of as the S twist on plied fibers and the Z twist, and align them differently so that the light cuts across in different ways in the morning and at night, natural daylight. But I saw it and thought about it in South America in the old pre-Incaic weaving, and then came across it again in a very large, much larger scale. And
this rope.
I'm more or less saying the same thing on the track, but it's nicer to say it.
It's a live narration event.
Here, here's the fabric. You see the indentation? Those are woven in.
But
tedious work, but you can do that in handwork. This is one of the oldest and largest hand weaving factories in the world.
It's in India.
Kozhikode, Calicut, Malabar Coast.
How long did you work with them?
Going back and forth for 5 years and then continuing another 8 years. And
This was in the 1970s?
I went 60s, 65 onwards. I flew on Air India. The placemat, the carpet, the upholstery were all things that I had made. I made all these things anonymously. That's why they kept inviting me back. Because the idea was to go into their production, work for them, with them, help them. And in the I check in the Taj Mahal Hotel, I think it was called, in Bombay, and I used this and my bed cover was from this workshop. And I'd go down the lobby, I'd sit on the canapé, and the upholstery was from this room. So it was very gratifying. I mean, I was not signing, or no one knew who I was making, but it was such a pleasure to be able to go into their space, their place, and find my place within the ensemble. It was a wonderful experience.
And you've done that a number of times in different countries.
I do it over and over again because it's a golden ticket to be invited back. I don't ask for royalties. You know, I don't dicker and I go for the pleasure of having access to that much material, that much willingness to experiment, and eagerness to realize, produce, and perpetuate. Because a lot of these fabrics that I made in this workshop were produced not only by the meter. By now, they're still producing by the kilometer. And continues.
To work in the morning?
You said to a group of us the other day, how do I get these opportunities? I pick up the phone.
That's how I got recruited for this job.
Mm-hmm. And for many others, I would imagine.
Right. Based on those ideas. I better get home and pick up the phone.
What do you mean you have 5 cell phone numbers?
She got mad at me today because she called me and said, what number is this? I'm going to cross out the other one. And I said, no. And she said, well, I've got 5 numbers here. They're all active for one reason or another.
Well, depending on which country you're in or who's calling. Oh, you're saying I have my own number for you?
You can
the bat phone.
You can reach me day and night if it's really urgent on this certain number.
We will give it to you later.
And if it's like we're...
Now here you're working...
Here we're in Morocco.
In Morocco.
In the dye pits in Fez. And the women, the tattooed women, and sorting the wool. And here's the basis for many of my, what I call prayer rugs, that are sejada, that are hanging on the wall. I took them up from the floor, the prayer rugs.
Here's one.
And hung them on the wall. And the
wall carpets.
And the manufacturers could charge 4 times more because they came up off the floor and went up on the wall.
And you mentioned here that you went, you had traveled extensively in South America, of course, but by then you were residing in Paris from 1964.
I missed Mexico terribly when I left Mexico.
Mm-hmm. It sort of takes its own shape.
And Matthias, who you saw photographed, said, Sheila, don't be a crybaby. You have Morocco, an hour and a half, 2 hours from Paris. Mm-hmm. So when every time you... lament, missing the handwork, colors, people, food, all in Mexico, then go to Morocco. So I signed a contract with the Moroccan government, Ministry of Artisana. Mm-hmm. I went down and did carpets, rugs, designs. But here we're in Sweden, sorting laundry. And with these tons of to make an exhibition in Lund, Sweden, it's a university town. That were these soft, the director who's sitting on the left there, on your left maybe, I asked her to requisition laundry from the local hospital, have it shipped in, and with their staff, with a thread. Like all the people just working in the museum, help me, and we hung the entire museum with the laundry.
Tons of laundry.
Beautiful. It was a beautiful museum, beautiful architecture, so it was natural daylight. And we could, and here, this is darning from a Carmelite convent.
Tiny points of darning.
But it's like beautiful writing, isn't it? Writing with thread.
Holes here, so you have to refill the holes.
And you,
These are darn sheets, by the way.
You worked with them and you've shown this work. You've shown essentially their work.
Mattress pad. Mm-hmm. Darned. It's a rough textile, you can see. It's a pretty crusty textile. But the darning is, and here are the bottoms of the socks that the nuns wore because they wore clogs. So what the socks would wear out on the bottom, not the heels. Isn't it beautiful the way they would darn them?
I love especially these, I've seen some of these in person, and that you... These are their darn socks, and you're sort of putting them in front of us and saying, look at how beautiful this is, look at how important this is to look at. But you have also, in a sense, made studies of this kinds of textures that can appear in textiles in some of your miniature works.
Well, I look at threads that have an established grid that's been ruptured. Of course, in knitting, it's not a grid. It's other than grid, than the right angle. But when the threads rupture, and you try to reunite the threads in a clumsy way, which is darning quite often, the handwriting bursts. It comes out of the background and sort of is embedded and floats at the same time. And it's fascinating to see how you work and move threads around.
Mm-hmm. I think a lot of people don't really know how to darn anymore. You just buy new socks.
Try.
So that concludes that film, and this is now going to just roll into the next one. And I have a question for you while it's doing that. So you moved to Paris in 1964, and you have lived there ever since. You have your studio there. You work in a studio model, an atelier model, with a number of people. I'm thinking about, you know, as an expat, as you are, what Paris has sort of offered you that perhaps another city might not, or other cities might not. What's kept you there for so many years, besides that it is your home?
At the beginning, it was Orly Airport.
Okay.
You know, then it became Charles de Gaulle Airport. Mm-hmm. And the private jets come in Le Bourget. So there are three airports within 35 minutes of my house. And I do travel, and I do like to work in different places. Mm-hmm. Paris is very, very convenient. Mm. Now, if you raise children also, the French school system is marvelous.
And you have two children.
So I have a stepdaughter, which I was raising when I first, and I have a daughter and a son. They've all gone to the École Alsacienne at the Jardin Luxembourg in Paris, if you know the region, in the little 6th arrondissement near the Metro Odeon. And I would walk them to school, go through the Jardin Luxembourg, sit and have coffee, read the newspaper, go to work. It was something worth perpetuating.
Mm-hmm. That sounds really nice. She's and still doing that, too, I must
say. I'm still doing that
say.
Because now I have three grandchildren, mm-hmm. age 7, 17, 14. And so we're still in the same neighborhood, and they're going to the same school where my son and daughter went. Only now the director of this school, Dr. Pierre de Panafure, was a little boy who used to spend vacations with us in Brittany.
In the late 50s.
He's a historian. He's a well-known historian in Paris. But he's the director of the school, so I have great confidence in him educating my grandchildren now.
Right.
Now, where do you find that today?
Then I had Fulbright and went to South America.
So here we're going to talk about different ways of working. Here's Machu Picchu, of course.
This film is called Four Channels of Investigation.
Architecture is very important to me. At Yale, Louis Kahn directed the architecture department. Albers was directing the art department, Louis Kahn the architecture, George Kubler, art history, you know, pre-Columbian, Vincent Scully, history of architecture. Here's my pylons again.
So it's quite a heady brew at Yale, 1954.
Here's a photograph I made of Luis Barragan in his home in Mexico City, here he is, with Matias sitting on the stairway after lunch. Here's a structure by Felix Candela in Mexico. I photographed and did all the prep work for a film, a documentary film on Candela. Photography's been one of my tools. This is not so far from the Candela pliable plane. Maybe I'm the only one who feels that, but
well,
there are some architects here. The idea of the pliable thread, the pliable plane, and textiles and architecture, and here is the Ford Foundation in New York in 1967, 68, which I've just reconstructed completely and will be inaugurated, and Jenelle will come and help speak on October 8th in New York, if any of you want to come.
It's private.
We come in the
side. We'll give you Sheila's number, as we said.
We come in the side door.
The talk.
These are George Jensen's showroom in New York. I did three different environments. Here's a Boeing 747.
Hot stuff.
this is Boeing, and this is in my studio in Paris. And I won some kind of a competition to do the first Boeing 747 for Air France, the interior of the first class. And It kept going and kept going. We did about 18 or 19 of these planes, and I couldn't possibly do it in my studio, so I went out to the Carmelite convent in Boulogne, near Paris, and the nuns, who are a silent order, loved working on this very quietly. On this,
they did the embroidery and they did of the panels.
They said it was like doing the inside of Jonah, the whale.
And those were the same nuns that of the darned socks.
Of the darned socks.
Sheets, correct.
So this sounds folkloric, but serious. I'm very serious about my work. I'm telling you sort of stories so you don't get bored.
Here are some photos of some of the larger works, and you have worked at a massive scale, an architectural scale, when you showed the picture of Felix Candelas to sort of show how you translated in your work some of the, you know, very large actual literal architecture into soft materials to create certain kinds of architecture, to create spaces, which is, of course, the history of tapestry. Tapestries were used to make rooms and stone castles. Here's another picture of those shirts. And some of the images we've seen so far, Sheila, are very colorful. And there's one of my favorite quotes that you have said is, one color is easy, and two colors are a confrontation. Do you...
And three, it really gets complicated.
Yeah, I was going to say, do you court that confrontation? No?
Here we go, one, two, three.
Laundry.
This is in a converted prison, and I've taken nurses' blouses from the Lausanne hospital and dyed them in my washing machine, or two washing machines. I broke one. And just tried, you know, converting these nurses' blouses into different successive lives.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Here's in Saudi Arabia. Of course, I'm taking photographs because then I'll base my work on these kind of things that I observe. Here is in Rabat, in the National Gallery in Morocco. Here, natural wool with a prayer rug form. And here is one that's... when I didn't have furniture in a studio during 1968, I put cardboard boxes in the middle of the studio, and I put one of these big Moroccan carpets over it, and we used it as furniture. As a place, and then habit, you know, habit. I often think I'm going to end up doing that again. Here's in the tapestry workshop of Aubusson, you know, the national treasures of France are classical tapestries, haute lisse and basse lisse. So I've worked in Aubusson, and I've worked recently in Gobelin in Paris.
Here's one of your notebooks, which are you've been keeping for years and years. Amazing scrapbook, journals, sketches for works. Really, quite an archive at this point.
This is my courtyard, looking out the living room window, and reaching out, and as we're about to ship, you know, to roll and ship. And here's a project for Japan.
Not the use of any utensils, tools.
That's the Fuji City Cultural Center, 103 meters long, 300 and something feet, 330 feet maybe.
Yeah, these are the panels just...
Here we're looking out the window again.
Put up end to end.
Looking out the window, photographing before they're being knocked down, rolled, created, packed, sent to Fuji City. Here they're being installed.
I'd like to tell the audience a little about your studio, which is about 1/8 of the size of this stage or so, maybe a little larger, maybe 1/4 the size of this stage, your current studio. So the amazing thing about this material...
I keep trying to stop.
Yeah. The amazing thing about this material, as you can imagine, is that you can make something like this in a small size room, studio, because it's soft and it can be rolled, it can be taken outside. Where Sheila's studio is, there is this kind of nicely sized courtyard, but it's a shared courtyard, and actually people walk through it.
To go to school.
So, you know, you can imagine seeing an artist drag all their work out there to check the sizes and ship it and see how it looks in the daylight. But I'm amazed at the scale of the works that have come out of that room. It's quite a production a space of production.
There's the courtyard. Mm.
This is a different courtyard.
It's the same, but it's another side.
Oh, view.
And here's a stage curtain that's being collaged in Kiryu in Japan. I could also work. And I made it in Kiryu. I like this mission sometimes when someone says we want to do something, we want to use our own materials, our own techniques, our own workers, our own history, our own tradition, and we want to do something completely new. That's the way to go.
Since we're talking over the film too, and it's called Four Channels of Investigation, what are those four channels of investigation?
I say closed compositions, which mm-hmm. are defined spaces that you know it's going to be 7 feet by 12 feet or something. Open compositions, when you start to figure out a modular system, that if the builders and the owners, when they start seeing the models coming in, they say, oh, good, it's great, go for it, let's do it three times bigger, mm-hmm. you know, that you can.
Which is like the work upstairs in the show, the Banisteriopsis, for example, sort of, it's a module and it can go to...
Oh, we can fill the whole room
any
upstairs.
Any scale, exactly. Yeah. Let's do it.
Yes. Well, these are the elements I'm working on. I'm taking cork, which mm-hmm. is a very attractive material for the fire department because it's non-flammable. And cork bands from Portugal, I'm hand wrapping them. Mm-hmm. So they have a flat ribbon-like sinuous structure. I'm taking an idea of a model of a knot that was a paperweight on my father's desk that I picked up when he died and mm-hmm. sort of paid homage to him and made a knot. And I made it for Target headquarters in Minneapolis. Mm-hmm. But I shipped it all in segments and erected it in place, you know.
Yeah. And I think this piece lets us talk about sometimes the fate of public commissions, of which you've done so many. Target commissioned.
By the way.
Yes.
Target decided after ten years, they were sacking the lobby and making it into all offices.
Yeah.
So this...
They paid for that, and 5 years later they said...
Yeah. Then they alerted me, what do you think we should do now? And so we put it out, put the news out, mm-hmm. and the Mint Museum in Charlotte said, what about our lobby? Mm-hmm. So it's installed in their lobby now.
In a different form.
In a different form,
yeah.
A vertical form.
Mm-hmm. And here you are at the restaurant in New York City called SD26. Beautifully designed space.
You have a great memory.
Where?
Good.
She's taken me there like it's her clubhouse. No, but she was commissioned to make works for the restaurant, which actually change. You've been changing a few of them. So here is one of the works in the restaurant.
It's on
the bar area.
East 26th Street.
Yeah, this is recent, just a few years back.
It's called... There's Massimo Vignelli, who designed the restaurant.
Recently passed away. You know,
recently passed away. Building
there, a very important designer. Very important designer.
Graphic designer.
Every time you go to an American national park, that brochure they give you with the black band.
And the metro system in New York, too. Mm-hmm. All the maps.
So he's an old friend of yours, somebody you've worked with before. And he designed this restaurant, from the menus to the building, and you did some of these works.
And he said, what are we going to put in the restaurant to make it a nice place for people to hang out? Mm-hmm. So he let me imagine things. And the owners, he's passed away, unfortunately. The owners have given me sort of a meal ticket to come there when I'm in the States. They gave it to me because I live in Paris, and they know I won't come every day.
Yeah.
But the idea is for me to keep adding, changing, and modifying and mm-hmm. doing things in their restaurant.
So, Sheila, we said open compositions, closed compositions. The third channel of investigation?
Ephemeral mm-hmm. compositions. Here today, gone tomorrow.
Yes.
You know, sort of a performance or an installation, an environment.
Like the laundry.
And when you come back, it's no longer there. Mm-hmm. And you still remember it. But and the fourth, what is the fourth? We had it down pat.
It's not the miniatures, right? It's not the miniatures.
No? All of them. I'll think it up.
We decided not to rehearse, so it'd be super fresh for all of you.
Open, closed, ephemeral. By the time we get finished, I'll figure it out.
So the next film that we'll see is a short film about a material that you're currently working with, which is also on view. No, we're going to do that one last. The next one is documentation of an exhibition that you had a couple of years ago.
Recent show. So we've been showing things working in workshops, factories, industry, architecture. Now we're going to show
the show you had in London at Alice and Jake's
Gallery? An exhibition. Well, that's a kind of short-lived. There's the four categories.
Oh.
Closed compositions, ephemeral.
Locked compositions.
Locked, keep going.
So many new ideas.
Well, I mean, you work along different lines and you can't apply.
Didn't tell us.
I think it's got to, we've got to switch films.
Yeah. He's the only person that knows how to do this. He's the puppet master.
This is my studio with Albers. Mm-hmm. When I was in school, with Albers explaining to me, what are you trying to do, girl?
tell us a little more. That's a great story.
He used to come in and he didn't know my name, so he only called me girl.
In German.
No, in English. It's the one word he knew, in girl. And he'd say, he'd walk in, he'd look, and I was, not only was I painting, making photographs, drawing, doing prints, sculpture down in the basement, and with these little textile things that I was trying to teach myself how threads work together, he came in and he said, "Was ist das, girl?" Because don't forget, he was married to an expert weaver. So this looked like really nothing at all. So he then said, "Thursday after class, I'm taking you home to meet my wife." And the man who was painting in the stall next to me, we had like horse stalls, came over and said, after Albers left, he said, "You don't go home with your professor." As if I didn't know. But I thought it through, and I thought, what choice do I have? I mean, this was the director of the school, and he's taking me home to meet his wife. I better figure out, I was so naive into my own.
You were young. You were in college.
Who is his wife anyway? Why do I have to meet his wife? Who's going to put me on the right track or something? He drove me out to the suburbs. It was so sad.
The suburbs were sad? Yes. Or the drive was so sad?
In New Haven. It was North Haven or somewhere. It was out in outside of New Haven on a rainy, terrible in the winter, what it's like in New Haven. And we went into this little wooden clapboard house. Well, yesterday I visited the Gropius house here in the rain, which I enjoyed very much.
Mm-hmm. In Lincoln.
And I was thinking that here are these incredible personalities, these German Bauhaus masters and their wives and things coming over. They were living in these very small, reduced size area things, perfectly organized. We went in, there was no furniture. We sat on a car seat, the back end of a car seat.
Had they just moved there?
No, this was their furniture. This was what he considered appropriate furniture, Bauhaus. Mm.
Uncomfortable? No, that's not Bauhaus.
It looked like an old Ford car back seat, And I sat with his wife, mm-hmm. and he said, show her what you're doing. Well, she looked at this scornfully. Tried not to show it, but it was obvious. And I said I was taking an art history course with Kubler, and I was fascinated about these pre-Columbian textiles. And I was trying to teach myself how they were made. I was trying to figure it out. And the book I was reading that you refer to in your book, mm-hmm. can I see your book? Mm-hmm. This is the new book for the show. It's fantastic. The designer is sitting in the audience, so he'll be happy that we open it.
Thank you.
Look at this, it's great. Look what happens. Isn't that beautiful? When you speak of tech, you do a book about textiles, and then you actually put real textiles on it. Anyway, in the book, Jenelle talks about how I discovered these pre-Columbian textiles, taking this art history course. I tried to get the book out of the library of, it was in French, Darcourt was his name. And it was signed out, and the librarian told me it had been signed out for, you know, keep signing out and then re-signing out. I could see the name. Annie Albers. So we were on the same track, so her husband understood that maybe she was much further along than I was. She might give me a little help. And then he took me and left me at the bus stop.
He didn't drive you back.
He didn't drive me back to New Haven. Because he was down in the basement. He had a studio down in the basement where there were just these little windows, you know, on the level of the ground. I was talking to the architect yesterday, Mr. Olson, who's sitting here. Albert's studio was down in the basement. You know, these wonderful paintings of Albert's? He was painting these down in the basement where there was just little light on the ground level, like...
Mm-hmm. Yeah, like just below grade, sort of, mm-hmm. right.
So he dropped me off at the bus stop, and I had an epiphany at the bus stop in New Haven. And I still remember. And it was, with what I was learning about color from Albers, because I was taking his color course every semester, mm-hmm. over and over again, I was fascinated. I was really drawn into his interaction of color course. Huh? What I was learning about color, and then what I was trying to learn about threads, crossing. All the time I was painting, of course, and that's how I got the Fulbright as a painter. Mm-hmm. But the threads won out. And I thought, imagine threads crossing in space, moving, becoming dimensional, tactile, and in incredible colors. I mean, how can you beat that? Mm-hmm. And I got on the bus, and it was, I think it was raining that day, and I thought, I've got it all together. Mm-hmm. I've got it all together, because this is the way it's going to go.
And you were, what, 20 years old?
I was, that was 1956, 7. I was born in 1934.
22. Next, have it all figured out.
Yeah, no turning back.
22.
no turning back. And then he was on the committee of Fulbright, so he got a Fulbright scholarship for me to go to Chile, which I quickly went to the library and looked up to figure out where it was.
And you continued to meet with Annie Albers a few times.
I think she threw me out after about four times. I was losing her time. Because I wasn't even interested in keeping straight salvages. Mm-hmm. I wasn't even interested in the alignment, you know, Bauhaus style. Like some of the weavings you have upstairs where mm-hmm. the videos are. Mm-hmm. Beautiful, perfect weaving. Mm-hmm. That didn't really turn me on. I was on another tangent. Mm-hmm. I was freeing things from the loom rather than in restricting them. That was my direction. I was really a free bird.
Yes, I would say. I think you're fearless in a way that is very unusual.
I think I'm from Nebraska and I'm scared of everything. And to prove it, I do everything I can to break that fear.
Yes. Hmm?
or to harness it and to move along.
You've been everywhere in the world. You've lived very many places in the world. And you've been making artwork and pressing the questions about this material for 50 years.
Well, the materials help me not to get lost. Mm. Because if I see a bus go by, I get on it.
Or pick up the phone.
Or pick up the phone. But I've got the thread. And the thread keeps me with some kind of a logical, sequential, chronological growth. Mm-hmm. Because all cultures in the world live, work, appreciate, and are enhanced by whatever is made with thread. Mm-hmm. So our cultures, since time beginning, in the beginning of time, the oldest professions in the world, I guess, are agriculture and working with thread and material, you know, to clothe ourselves, to keep us warm, to house us. So if it's the oldest profession in the world...
Wait, isn't something else the oldest profession in the world?
I'm lobbying for thread.
From the very ancient professions to... You know, to where we started with this lecture, with this kind of the very traditional methods, the traditional materials. I want to play this film, and we're going to just scooch past that other one. But to play this film about a material that you're working with right now, which is the newest high-tech kind of fabrics. This is a very recent video of the material that you see upstairs, the large column piece. It's made of this material, and this is how it's made. This is a very fascinating material. And so that's another thing that interests me in your work. Yes, you have worked with wool and cotton and linen and all those old vegetable and animal fibers. And here you've got something absolutely manufactured from, essentially.
Can we turn off the lights? Is there any way to turn off the lights?
It's magic.
Yes.
So tell us about this. You still like to stick your hands in everything. Tell us what this is.
I'm trying to figure out.
Yeah. Christmas. That's my face when we open crates when we're installing upstairs. So here, you're in South Carolina. This material, which starts as pure pigment.
In Turkey.
Is bound with an acrylic medium.
Binder, in Germany.
Germany.
So there are all these patents involved. Mm-hmm. Gets shipped to the United States. That's continent one to continent two to continent three. Mm-hmm. So try and copy them.
In North and South Carolina, it's plied. It's pulled into thread.
It's plied, pulled into thread.
Yeah.
We'll see it.
So what looks like rope upstairs is all threads, hundreds of threads that are plied. Here you are in beautiful New Jersey. I've been lost on that road lots of times. And this is the material that we recognize from upstairs. And you're picking out the colors you want to use.
We've had them all dyed, but they haven't really been dyed. It's real pigment.
It's a really fascinating material.
It's the story they told. The way they turned me on is they said, come and see. I mean, simple. A simple story is this. Do you know the difference between a radish and a carrot? I mean, everybody does, almost. So the radish has color on the outside, and it's applied. Like most textiles and fibers are dyed, and the core and the material is dyed, and it takes on the color, which doesn't always penetrate all the way to the core of the fiber. Mm-hmm. Whereas the carrot is pigment through and through. You can throw this pigment in a bath of Clorox, as I say, and you can go away on vacation and come back 2 months later, and the Clorox is still colorless, and the fiber is totally intact, the color. So it's a material that's been developed for marine textiles, mm-hmm. boats, outdoor awnings. It's a fiber and textile that I can use to make things indoors or outdoors. Mm-hmm. So I'm trying.
And you've just started working with this about a little over a year ago or so.
Started in Whitney Biennale is the first time I presented it.
It was
in January, I think.
Yeah.
So I started in October last year, about a year ago. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So this is a material that really excites you now, and you're thinking a lot about it. You've already made several pieces with it.
And I've got another material in mind right now. Mm-hmm. But I'm not ready to leave this one behind yet.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And it does things besides just hanging there. It does things. You can manipulate it. You can change the shape of it.
It has a memory. Mm-hmm. It's very interesting because if when you've tightly wrapped it, enveloped it, and then begin to twist it, and then you begin to, you'll see when you untwist it, it has a memory.
Mm-hmm. And this is essentially how we installed the work upstairs. It's just hung from the ceiling in these kind of chunks of mixed color and monochromatic color.
You can sculpt with it.
Mm-hmm. And that's the finisher. So we only have a few more minutes. I think we should take some questions if you're interested. So if we could have the lights up a bit. And please ask anything you want of Sheila Hicks. We'll give you her phone number again after. And just give me a moment to repeat the question back so the whole audience can hear it. Does anyone? Yes. So she's asking if Sheila funds her own work, especially with, I imagine, all the people involved and the people who work with you.
You mean over the last 50 years? Or be more specific, because I'd like to give you really a clear answer.
Do you have a specific work in mind that you are wondering?
Think of
the Target piece?
Like the Target piece. Mm-hmm. That's a client. Target Corporation financed the execution, the design, execution, and installation. Mm-hmm. And then we're generous enough that when they altered their headquarters in Minneapolis to offer it back to me, asking, where would you like this to go? Of course, they are a corporation, so they figured out they could write off their taxes probably mm-hmm. if they donated it to some cultural institution. But at least it wasn't like some of the other places. The Rothschild Bank, when Mitterrand came in as president and the Rothschild Bank was nationalized, the employees just cut up the whole wall and took pieces home.
this is not so unusual. This can happen in sort of public situation.
Uh-huh. The bank had financed, the design, the execution, the installation. So their employees felt proprietorial about this, and they weren't willing to share it with the government. They each took a piece home.
And what about, I mean, this material? There's so much of it here.
Sunbrella. Oops.
That is not a plug. Sunbrella is one of the companies that works. It's like Kleenex. It's a brand that uses the technology.
We ask that without putting their name on. They're very clever about their marketing. They don't want their name on anything, mm-hmm. but they're perfectly willing to help me play with this material. Mm-hmm. You see, look at the fiber, and to show them what I think can be done with it. Mm-hmm. It expands their own company's design development mentality. So a lot of, if you're lucky, and this is the Palais de Tokyo in Paris, the museum. It's open until midnight every night. And the people are allowed to come in and hang out.
I'm looking.
It's free until midnight. Mm-hmm. And this space they've given, the Palais de Tokyo has given over to me for a year, and I can keep changing it and trying new things and doing different things. And I asked this three companies, will they come along with us on the ride and help? You know, because it's for culture. Here is in Basel at the design fair. Susan Demish had contacts there and asked me if I wanted to do something for the entrance of the last design fair in the Basel Art Fair. I'm wandering though, answering your question. I have a small studio, like a pilot laboratory, where I'm playing all the time and making small things. And I contract assistants, and quite often they're apprentices from the art schools and textile schools. Denmark, Belgium, Italy, people come, knock on the door, send me emails, come by for a while. Can we do a stage? Can we do a little apprenticeship in your street? If I have a project going and we need help, yes. And when they check in, I say they have to have their papers in order. They have to be legal, and they have to be willing to speak French. So there's a unified atmosphere in my studio. There are people from Greece, from Korea, from Japan, but they must all make an effort to speak the language that we speak in the studio, which is French. And we all have lunch together. That's another. And they're not on cell phones, no cell phones in the studio.
Yes, that's another reason to live in Paris.
They can go out and make calls. Many of them have families or obligations and things like that, and they go out in the courtyard, but they don't interfere the atmosphere of the studio where we're working and trying to create. I don't know. Also, last thing I wanted to say, they have to have their papers in order and have that way. We have health insurance in France, as you know. It's very important.
Rub it in.
I feel pretty strongly, like, why do I live in France? You
yeah.
ask me? There are a lot of things that I feel comfortable about. And everyone comes in, and I say they're like taxi meter. If they're coming into my studio, they're being alert, awake, cooperative, and productive. And at the end of the month, they're paid. Nobody works for free. None of it is slave labor or, what do you call these, interns?
I worked for free. I worked for free. I'll wait for my check.
When she came, or when people like, well, there's no one like Jenelle, so there's nobody to compare her to. But when people walk in the door and they want to sit and talk to me for a half hour about something, I say, if you don't mind, sit here because I'm busy making this and help me. And if they're cooperative, you know, we work and talk together. And she was very cooperative, and we had a good time working together. And we worked on the Ford Foundation project. So it's great when she comes in and sees it in New York next week. Because mm-hmm. she helped sew one of the medallions.
Mm-hmm. So, can I just say that when then we went to see it and Sheila said, oh, I think that's the one you helped sew. I can see the mistake in it. Let's take another question. Yes.
So I'm really quite familiar with your absolutely beautiful, wonderful work. Really, thank you. It seems to me that, you know, like in the beginning, you were taking your imagery, your inspiration, a lot from architecture, you know, in Mexico, in all of the countries. From that, and also just from the materials themselves, you know, in the spinning, the dyeing, mm-hmm, mm-hmm. natural fibers.
She's been listening. Uh-huh.
Like, well, me like you're off on your own, and I'm wondering, like, well, where is your inspiration coming from? You know, like the last one with the wonderful, you know, peaky places to sit and roll and, you know, and so on. I mean, there are common threads, you know, but it's like everything now is like more colorful, very different materials, very different kind of imagery.
So your question is, or Sheila's inspiration, but I kind of feel like we just did that.
The current inspiration is the pouring rain on the road to Andover.
Yesterday. It's everything that you're experiencing currently. Is that, I think, if I could put words into your mouth, which isn't usually allowed. But you're always traveling. You're always looking. You're responding often immediately to a material, to a space, to...
The lobby here is crying for something.
Unbelievable. Are you on her side? Let's take another question.
You drive in, you know, you come to the museum, you get here, all these construction site, you know, it's extraordinary. You know, something's really happening here. It's everything's growing around this building. I photographed with your assistant the other day, waiting for a car to pick us up. I photographed all the men who were operating these cranes, and the sky, dramatic. The rain was coming, so it was cloudy and tumultuous. And thinking of that little man up in that box, you know, in the crane, inspiration. What would it be like to be up there in the sky and carrying and lifting these I-beams up there, one by one, modular elements, accumulating and building and building, and then come and look around and see here, walking in, glass, water. This is how I think. Glass, water. That lobby, waiting for the taxi, or waiting for a group to assemble. Where is the fiber?
And where then is the fiber? And then it's on the fourth floor.
Yeah. But I'm looking at this, and I'm standing there with a Swiss friend who's in the show, too. And we look at these silly little lampshades in the bookstore.
Worst guest ever. Where does the Palais de Tokyo piece go after its year in Paris?
Where does this piece go after it takes its tour for the next year? It's going three museums. Her show is traveling to...
The Wexner Center and the Des Moines Art Center. Ohio and then Iowa.
It's not even going overseas. It's already here.
I'm sending it back to you. I'm keeping it! Yeah. Well, we have time for one more question. I'm going to weigh in the back. You're trying so hard. Ask it! The question is about her color choices.
I think I did that when I told you I took all of Albert's color course over and over again.
And now, then, bearing in mind, too, that this color course that you took was before the book. The color course was in preparation for his very famous book, which you've all now probably studied.
In the Interaction of Color book and the Albers book about Albers and his students, they used some of the exercises I was doing in those courses. And when I went to Chile and got there and checked in at the Fulbright office, they sent me to the Universidad Católica and told me I was assigned to teach the 2- and 3-dimensional course and color, basic design, to first-year architecture students. Albers had already been there in Chile, had already set up his course at the invitation of the rector of the university, Sergio Larraín. And he said he'd send one of his students every year to perpetuate the course. He was very devious. He sent me there to perpetuate the course. So I taught that course, Albers' course, two and three-dimensional design and color to young architecture in Spanish.
Mm-hmm.
All boys. Can you imagine how much fun that was? And so color, for me, is my primary language. First comes color, then comes English, then comes Spanish, then comes French, mm-hmm. and thread.
Mm-hmm. That is a really beautiful place to end. Thank you, Sheila.